Bob, I think part of the advantage I have is I'm not a lawyer. And so as a historian, I look at the context of the justice, of the judiciary and the Constitution in terms of American history. The fact is, I'll just give you two examples. Judge Beery's ruling on June 1st that he would jail the superintendent if anybody at the high school graduation used the word benediction, used the word invocation, asked for a moment of silence, ask the audience to stand, or mention God. He would jail the superintendent. It's such an anti-American dictatorship of speech that there's no reason the American people need to tolerate a federal judge who is that out of sync with our entire culture. And so you have to ask the question, is there any alternative? What's the recourse? Well, one recourse is impeachment. The Supreme Court in Boumediene literally inserted the American civil liberties onto the battlefield. Now, this is the opposite of World War II, where Franklin Delano Roosevelt told the Supreme Court through his Attorney General that the 14 German saboteurs that had been picked up in the U.S. would be tried by military tribunal and executed, and that he would not tolerate a writ of habeas corpus as the commander-in-chief. And so you have this real problem that since 1958, when the Warren Court asserted by itself that the Supreme Court was supreme over the President and the Congress, you've had a fundamental assault on our liberties by the courts. You have an increasingly arrogant judiciary. And the question is there anything we, the American people, can do? Well, the standard conservative answer has been, well, eventually we'll appoint good judges. I think that's inadequate. The Constitution promises a balance of the judicial branch, the executive branch, and the legislative branch. The Federalist Papers says specifically, the weakest of the three branches is the judiciary. Jefferson abolishes 18 out of 35 federal judges.
They've just been created.
They've just been created and they've been appointed. And he abolishes them, over half of all the judges. Jackson says of the court, they think the Bank of the United States is constitutional. I don't think it's constitutional. And their opinion doesn't matter to me. I'm the president. They're over in the judiciary. He vetoes it. Lincoln spends part of his first inaugural, because people tend to forget, the Supreme Court in Dred Scott ruled that slavery extended to the whole country. And Lincoln says very specifically, that's the law of the case, it is not the law of the land. Nine people cannot create the law of the land, or you have eliminated our freedom as a people.
Mr. Speaker, the old saying in legal circles is that the Supreme Court is not last because it's right. It's right because it lasts. It's last. There comes a point where you have to accept things as the law of the land. How do you decide? How does the president decide what's a good law and I'm going to obey the Supreme Court, or what's a bad law and I'm just going to ignore it?
I think it depends on the severity of the case. I'm not suggesting that the Congress and the president review every decision. I'm suggesting that when there are decisions, Boumediene is an example, in which they are literally risking putting civil liberty rules in battlefields. I mean, it is utterly irrational for the Supreme Court to take on its shoulders the defense of the United States.
Well, but
it's a violation of the Constitution.
But Brown versus Board of Education was a very controversial decision. There were a large number of people in the United States that didn't want to do that. Are you saying that had the president been so disposed, he could have just ignored that?
I'm saying that in the case of Dred Scott, which was a equally important and terrible decision. Remember, the court's sometimes right, the court's sometimes wrong.
Well, that was then, and this is
no,
now.
No, no, no. You can't be sure what the next court will do. And the question is, as a people, do we have a right to take the Ninth Circuit Court, which ruled the one nation under God was unconstitutional in the Pledge of Allegiance? Do we as a people, where over 90% of the country believes that's false, the Senate and the House overwhelmingly rejected it. Immediately, and they had a vote almost immediately, overwhelmingly rejected it.
All right, here's another one. This is now. Next year, the Supreme Court is going to take up Obama's health care proposal. What if they throw it out? Can President Obama then say, I'm sorry, boys, I'm just going to go ahead and go ahead and implement it? Could he do that?
The key question is, what would the Congress then do? Because there are three branches. And the
but could he do that?
He could try to do that, and the Congress would then cut him off. Because here's the key. It's always two out of three. If the president and the Congress say the court's wrong, in the end, the court would lose. If the Congress and the court say the president's wrong, in the end, the president would lose. And if the president and the Congress court agree, the Congress loses. The founding fathers designed the Constitution very specifically on Montesquieu's spirit of the laws, to have a balance of power, not to have a dictatorship by any one of the three branches.
Let me just tell you what several people have said about this. When the Des Moines Register announced that it was supporting Mitt Romney, it said one of the reasons was because he does not pander to extremes with attacks on the courts. And a number of conservatives, including two of George Bush's attorney generals, sure, Alberto Gonzalez and Michael Mukasey, both said, and I'm going to just quote what Mr. Mukasey said, and he told this to Fox News. He wasn't telling it to Mother Jones. He told this to Fox News. He said, quote, "Mr. Gingrich's proposal is dangerous, ridiculous, totally irresponsible, outrageous, off the wall, and would reduce the entire judicial system to a spectacle." Now, that's a conservative judge, or a conservative attorney general. How do you respond to that?
I think many lawyers will find this a very frightening idea. They've had this run for 60 years of pretending that judges are supreme, that they can't be challenged, that the lawyer class defines America. We've had rulings that outlawed school prayer. We've had rulings that outlawed the cross. We've had rulings that outlawed the Ten Commandments. We've had a steady secular drive to radicalize this country away from all of its core beliefs. I mean, what got me into this was the Ninth Circuit saying that one nation under God is unconstitutional. If we live in a country where Judge Beery can literally say, "I will put you in jail for saying the word benediction," there's something profoundly wrong with the judicial system that has moved to that kind of extreme behavior.
But I would also add that what happened in that case is that an appeals court overturned that judge.
Right, but that means
the system worked.
No, the local school board under the current ended up paying large legal fees. Let me give an example of how much this elitism permeates the system. The House Franking Commission says members of the House cannot say Merry Christmas in their official correspondence. Well, this is absurd, okay, but it's part of that same elite anti-religious belief structure which leads the courts to define that you're supposed to take down the Mount Soledad cross in San Diego, even though it's a historic cross. And I'm just suggesting to you, I got into this originally because of two things. The steady encroachment of secularism through the courts to redefine America as a non-religious country, and the encroachment of the courts on the president's commander-in-chief powers, which is enormously dangerous.
Let me just ask you this. We talk about enforcing it, because one of the things you say is that if you don't like what a court has done, that Congress should subpoena the judge and bring him before Congress and hold a congressional hearing. Some people say that's unconstitutional, but I'll let that go for a minute. I just want to ask you, from a practical standpoint, how would you enforce that? Would you send the Capitol Police down to arrest him?
If you had to.
Or
you'd instruct the Justice Department to send a U.S. Marshal. But let's take the case of Judge Beery. I think he should be asked to explain a position that radical. How could he say he's going to jail the superintendent over the word benediction and invocation?
Well,
you know, I would then encourage impeachment. Mm-hmm. But before you move to impeach him, you'd like to know why he said it. Now, clearly, since the Congress has the power to impeach.
What if he didn't come? What if he said, "No, thank you, I'm not coming"?
Well, but that is what happens in impeachment cases. In an impeachment case, the House studies whether or not the House brings them in. The House subpoenas them. And as a general rule, they show up. I mean, but you're raising the core question. Are judges above the rest of the Constitution, or are judges one of the three co-equal branches?
But in the other side of that, are the rest of us above the Constitution and obeying the law? I mean, at some point you have to say this is a nation of laws, and
we do, but I'll go back to Lincoln, who people generally think respected the law. Lincoln explicitly instructed his administration to not enforce Dred Scott. And he said flatly, "It's the law of the case, not the law of the land," and it's in his first inaugural. And by the way, if you go to newt.org, there's an entire paper outlining the history of this case. Because I knew I was launching a topic that no other presidential candidate in modern times has launched, and I knew it had to be intellectually defensible.
And that's why I'm spending so much time on it here. It's fair to say, I think you'd agree, Mr. Speaker, that the judicial system is already under enormous strain. It's almost impossible now to get a federal judge or certainly a Supreme Court justice confirmed. We go through these long, drawn-out things. I think there are, 80-something judgeships that are vacant right now out of 800. That's a tenth, I guess. Wouldn't this just add to this? Wouldn't it just throw the entire system into chaos? I mean, just sort of bring all three branches to a screeching halt.
We are in a
constitutional crisis.
This is why the 2012 election is really important. The reason we are so deadlocked is that you have an elite that still has an enormous amount of power, and they would appoint very radical judges. You have the vast bulk of the American people who are opposed to that, but they don't have enough power yet to stop the elite. And one of the key questions in 2012 is simple. Do you want to move towards American exceptionalism, reassert the Constitution, reassert the nature of America, or do you in fact want to become a secular European sort of bureaucratic socialist society? As long as these two sides are fighting, and this is not because people have bad personalities or because people are incompetent, there is a fundamental conflict underway about what kind of country we're going to be.